Good morning, everybody. Welcome into church. It is a beautiful morning outside. Maybe still a little wet for some people. If you wore heels, you might sink. But it is a beautiful morning. So welcome into service. We are so glad you are joining us for church this morning. It's a joy and an honor to gather together in the Lord's house. And today, I say we get our service started with a little, God is good. And all the time, God is good. Amen. That is right. It is a beautiful day to be in worship this morning. It is a beautiful day to worship from wherever you are. If you're joining us, that's wonderful. If you're joining on the stream, if you're here live, we are welcoming and excited that you're here with us. My name is Russell. I'm the youth director here. And if you look in your bulletin, I'll be filling in the part of the liturgist. That will be what I am doing this morning. But if you're a guest with us this morning, we are just joy that you chose to worship with us. We hope you have felt welcome and you found a comfortable seat in our sanctuary. If you're looking for the closest restrooms, those could be to my right, your left, down the hallway. You'll see those down there. If you're looking for the closest restrooms, if you're a guest with us this morning. But to get started, we do have a few announcements to go through just to let you know about some of the things we have coming up in the life of our church. The first one is our Wednesday Night Alive programming is up and rolling. This Wednesday, there's a meal at 6. I'm not sure who's doing it. Nachos this Wednesday. And then after that, starting at 6:30, is programming for all ages, from the littles all the way up to the young at heart, have programming available on Wednesday nights. We want to encourage everyone to come out and be a part of that. It gives you a chance to dig your roots a little deeper in your faith and a chance to fellowship with other believers and just hang out with your church family and get to know each other a little bit better. And that's Wednesday. Then on Sunday, we have Stone Soup coming up, where we all kind of gather up. We get up in the church van. We head into Quapaw Quarter United Methodist Church in Little Rock. We cook a meal and serve a meal to those in need. We'll leave the church at 1, be back at 5. Everyone is welcome to come serve. If you can't ride in the church van, you're fine to meet us up there. If you need to leave a little bit early, that's understandable too. You're still welcome to come help out. The more hands we have, the better the experience, the easier it is on everybody. So we want to encourage you, if you're interested in finding a way to get involved in a mission outreach in this church, Stone Soup is a great opportunity. And again, that's this coming Sunday, so February 5th. We'll leave the church at 1. And then the last announcement I have is that we have a church council meeting coming up. That is February 12th. So 2 Thursdays away, that's at 6:30. It is an open meeting to anyone in the church that wants to attend. If you want to know what's going on kind of on the business side of the church, you're welcome to show up and just kind of partake in the meeting, hear what's going on, give a little input if you want to, but it is an open meeting and that'll be the 12th. So 2 Thursdays away is that church council meeting. No, I'm sorry, the 9th. Oh, the 9th, y'all. It's all coming up. Bam, bam, bam. So the 9th, February 9th. I'm sorry, that's my fault. February 9th is church council. And it is an open meeting again, 6:30 p.m. in the fellowship hall. Everyone is welcome to attend to kind of find out what's going on the business side of church life. But with all those announcements being said, I want to encourage us to just go to the Lord in prayer to really get our service started. So let's pray, y'all. Heavenly Father, we come to you today just full of excitement and full of joy to be worshiping together with fellow believers. And Lord, this morning as we gather together as one body of Christ, I pray that you would send your Spirit on us. Just fill up this room, fill up whatever place we are worshiping in, and just allow us to feel your presence in our lives. Lord, and I pray that your presence is so calming and so stilling for us that we just lay aside all the distractions and focus solely on this time with you, because that is truly what the purpose of worship is all about. And Lord, in this time, I pray that you hear our prayers and you hear our praise and they are pleasing to you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you all please stand and join us this morning in majesty, worship His Majesty. One, two, three, four. That's good.
Worship His Majesty.
continue this morning with They'll Know We Are Christians by Our Love.
Y'all sound so good.
Oh, shucks.
Bind us together.
Okay. One, two, three.
Bind us.
all please stay standing for the affirmation of faith?
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith we now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Christ Jesus, the Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord to the end, that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen. I want to invite the kids to come forward for a message led by Reagan Powell.
A lot of kids this morning. Hey.
Coming in hot.
Can y'all find a spot? Is there room for all of us? Awesome. How are y'all doing this morning?
Good.
Good. Tired. Me too. So, have y'all ever heard the Bible story of Jesus washing his disciples' feet?
Yes.
Did y'all learn about that in Sunday school?
Yes.
What did y'all learn? Do y'all remember?
What are we supposed to do?
Serve others. Yeah, that's right. And Jesus served his disciples by washing their feet. Yeah. So just like Jesus washed his disciples' feet, I'm going to wash my dad's feet.
Now I'm going to wash your feet.
Well, your feet don't smell that good. They don't smell the greatest. So I'm going to skip out on that. They don't smell very good. So Mr. Russell has on shoes and clean socks, but the disciples, I don't think they had socks on, and they walked in dirt and mud and probably animal poop too. So no, it didn't.
One thing that I know, they would probably have to survive on their own.
Yeah. Their feet didn't smell that good.
Stinky.
They would be stinky, wouldn't they?
Yes.
But hey, let's pay attention, okay? So even though the disciples' feet didn't smell that good, Jesus still served them and washed their feet, right? Do you know that we can still serve just like Jesus did? That we don't really have to maybe not wash people's feet because they probably don't smell good. Do you know what ways we could probably serve others?
Washing dishes.
Maybe help out around the house.
Wash
your face.
And put up dishes and put mm-hmm. in dishes.
Yeah.
And praying. The belly.
Maybe another way we could serve is helping our teacher. Maybe we could help her pick up trash or push in chairs. Could pick up your toy mess, maybe clean up your room without being asked. Those are all really good ways. So this week, I have a challenge for y'all. I want y'all to find one way we can serve others. Maybe it's helping your teacher or cleaning up your room. Can y'all do that for me? Find one way you can serve and help out.
I'm a super speed.
You're super speed. Clean up super fast. All right, y'all ready? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for all these boys and girls up here. I pray that you help us find one way we can serve others this week. Please keep us safe and bring us here all back next week. I pray all this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Reagan. That was a great word. If you would like, there's a Bible sitting in front of you in your pew. I encourage you to grab it and flip it open. We're going to share together in our scripture reading this morning. It comes from the book of John, chapter 13. We'll be reading verses 1 through 17. And I think Miss Denise put the page number on there if you need to flip to it real quick, maybe. I hope that's right. I haven't checked the Bibles in the pews this morning, but it might be a quick little easy way to get there. But grab a Bible and let's read together, family. Before the Passover celebration, Jesus knew that his hour had come to leave this world and return to his Father. He had loved his disciples during his ministry on earth, and now he loved them to the very end. It was time for supper, and the devil had already prompted Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over everything and that he had come from God and would return to God. So he got up from the table, took off his robe, wrapped a towel around his waist, and poured water into a basin. Then he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel he had around him. When Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You don't understand now what I am doing, but someday you will." "No," Peter protested, "you will never, ever wash my feet." And Jesus replied, "Unless I wash you, you won't belong to me." Simon Peter exclaimed, "Then wash my hands and head as well, Lord, not just my feet." And Jesus replied, "A person who has bathed all over does not need to wash, except for the feet, to be entirely clean. And you disciples are clean, but not all of you. For Jesus knew who would betray him now. For Jesus knew who would betray him, and that is what he meant when he said, 'Not all of you are clean.'" After washing their feet, he put on his robe again and sat down and asked, "Do you understand what I was doing? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right because that's what I am. And since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. I have given you an example to follow. Do as I have done to you. I tell you the truth, slaves are not greater than their master, nor is the messenger more important than the one who sends the message. Now that you know these things, God will bless you for doing them." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I'm Reverend Justin Ledbetter. I want to welcome you this morning and as well to give welcome to those who are worshiping with us virtually on the stream. It is my honor, it's my privilege this morning to welcome church family, though, our speaker, and a couple of members of his family who are with us this morning. A lot of people know the Metters. They're kind of famous peeps, but I want to introduce them to you. You might or might not have had the chance to meet or know at least three of the super awesome Metters clan. So I want to put them on the spot. I know it's embarrassing, but I want to invite them to stand up if you will. Jeff and Kama, his lovely wife, they're sitting right down here to my left, to your right, and they've got their daughter, the super awesome Ruby in the back. We at least wave for us, Ruby. Many of you know her. She is cotton shed famous too, and is the best associate they have over there. I know personally, having once somehow tripped and cut my hand open and bleeding all over the place, and I was like, "Help me, help me, help me," and Ruby came to the rescue with a Band-Aid, so shout out and thank you, Ruby. Just a couple words, though, about this dynamic family and Jeff, who comes to share the message of God with us this morning. Currently, Jeff is the leader of the Hunger Relief Army. A number of us, and I'll just ask, if you have been a part of one of the food packing meals events the last year or two in our church and community, will you put your hand up, y'all? I know a number of us have. Last year, our church and a couple of our sister churches packed 50,000 meals for hungry people here in Central Arkansas. Jeff has facilitated and led and organized the feeding of more than a million people in the last couple of years in Central Arkansas. And has a goal that God has placed upon his heart for this year to prepare and to share over 600,000 meals with hungry Arkansans right here in Central Arkansas. Miss Kama is a teacher here in our schools. Jeff and Kama have served as missionaries and mission planners in communities across this country. Jeff and Kama launched a ministry that continues this to this day in Fort Worth, Texas, serving children in the inner city. God called them and led them to Denver, Colorado to do the same, to lead a ministry to teenagers and homeless people and street kids that also continues to this very day. They also have led missions in California and all over. But in any case, we're blessed to have Brother Jeff with us. I consider it a blessing to have just had the opportunity in the last couple of years to get to know Jeff a little bit, to pray with Jeff, to break bread with Jeff, to work with Jeff, and to be a part of the mission of feeding hungry people right here at home in Arkansas. Knowing that there's a mission in the world, and we see about it and hear about it on television and all the time in foreign lands and places, but to know that there is an incredible mission of feeding hungry people, children and students and parents and aging and older and single adults. And Jeff is a leader of that mission of feeding the hungry. And so I want to offer a prayer for Jeff and then invite him to come and to share what God has laid on his heart for this fifth Sunday as we worship and as we close out our blast off series for the first month with a message about service. So may we pray. God, we give you thanks for the gift of Brother Jeff, for his family, for their presence with us in worship. We pray your blessings upon his children and his children's children, wherever they may be today at worship or at work. We pray, God, that you will still his heart and his mind. God, that his words would be yours and that he would point us ever and always onwards in the message of Jesus. Thank you for his serving hands, having fed more than a million of our neighbors in just the last couple of years, and for a mission that he continues to lead in fellowship and in service with us and in so many of our brother and sister churches throughout Central Arkansas. And so God bless Jeff as he comes to bless us and to feed us and edify us with your word this day. For we pray by your spirit and in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Words are really fun, and just the right word will really help you communicate exactly what you're trying to get across. This is a rhetorical question. I mean, I'm not asking for a call and response, but do you have a favorite word? I have lots of favorite words for many different reasons, but here are a few to kind of prime your pump. I like parties. I like to work hard, and I like to play hard, and so here are a few of my favorite words. Festivity. Hootenanny. Shindig, Jamboree, Soiree, Hoedown, Luau, and Wingding. I don't use Wingding that much, but I just couldn't resist it. So turn to your neighbor and tell them one of your favorite words. 10 seconds, go.
If your neighbor's favorite word is biscuit, don't say it. Two words, okay. My wife, I was running into this with my wife and asked her about what her favorite word is. She said, I have a favorite phrase, if it means the one I say the most.
And I said, oh yeah, well what is that? She says, I tell my students, ask someone who listened. I thought it was really good because, you know, I've raised teenagers. So one of my other favorite words, my favorite church word maybe, is orthopraxy. Not orthodoxy, don't be confused. Orthodoxy, that is correct beliefs, which is important. Orthopraxy, though, is about what you believe about your beliefs. What do you believe about the tenets of your faith? We said some tenets of faith a while ago. We affirmed a creedal statement. Good, all good things. But orthopraxy is what you believe about those things. For instance, do you believe that they're true enough to do something about it? I did not come to offer you a new creedal statement or an old one, a new set of beliefs or an old set of beliefs to reaffirm. That's not why I'm here today. That's orthodoxy. And I'm not here to preach about that. I want to offer you something else. Orthodoxy says, yes, I agree with that doctrine. 1, 2, 3, 4. I agree with that. I concede. That is true and correct. Orthopraxy is when you put your effort where your mouth is. Because anybody can form their mouth to say that. More or less. Orthopraxy is when the tenets of your faith compel you to take action. Orthopraxy is when the tenets of your faith compel you to take risks. The devil would agree with just above 98% of the Apostles' Creed. You're familiar with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, our only Son, our Lord. Oh, there's the two words the devil wouldn't agree with. He'll take most of the whole thing. Yeah, she was born of a virgin, suffered under Pontius Pilate. He'll go along with all that, except for those two words, our Lord. Because when Jesus is our Lord, when Jesus is your Lord, when he is my Lord, that means I am saying yes to doing his will. Thank you. Y'all ain't Pentecostals, are you? But thank you for that. And I appreciate a little feedback. Yeah, when we call Jesus our Lord, we're agreeing to doing his will. So orthodoxy is a beautiful skeleton. And who needs a skeleton? Everybody. Everybody, no pun intended, needs a skeleton. It's a beautiful skeleton of facts to believe. Orthopraxy is the muscles that do the work, working off of the framework of those muscles. The right work is done because the beliefs are true. So don't think I'm throwing the facts out the window. They're just the beginning. You got to have a beginning if you're going to have an end. You got to have a step one if you're going to have a step two. So, I believe X, Y, and Z. That's step one. So, because I believe, I must do. That is step two. So, a lot of people, some of the people that taught me to love Jesus like crazy, they got hung up on step one. They're still arguing about which are the correct beliefs and facts. And they never got around to doing step two. I have a visual aid for you. What do you call it when someone just does step one over and over? 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. That's jazzercise, right? That ain't pure religion. That's Jane Fonda and jazzercise. And I'm no Jane Fonda. All right. I knew I could get you to agree with something on. All right, so here's a true story. I used to have a summer camp that taught discipleship stuff. We taught stuff like avoid debt and materialism so you can do more with your income. We taught the stuff that your grandmother taught you. Use it up, wear it out, make do or do without. Amen. We talked about world poverty and that we could do something about it. My Baptist pastor buddy in Tuscola, Texas, named Kenny, he said to me, I've sent our kids to camp every summer for years, and all they ever do is get born again, again and again. Every year they come home and tell me how they got saved, sanctified, and baptized. And I say, well, that's nice, little Johnny, but isn't that the fourth time you've done that? My pastor friend Kenny says, I want to send these kids to a camp to learn about discipleship because they've done took step one. It's time to take step two and three and four because following Jesus means taking lots and lots and lots of steps. Can I get an amen? So service to others is a spiritual growth stimulator. If you want to grow spiritually, you do service to others. Like foot washing that took place, that almost took place right here this morning. We need to hand out clothespins. So who knows what a clothespin is? Yeah, they also work for your nose, not just clothes, when it comes down to the real work of servanthood. The hard work of service helps you grow beyond the elementary material. The physical and emotional pain that accompanies serving others will teach you things that the very best academic Bible study will not. If you want to grow, you have to go. All right, if you want to grow, you have to go. You have to print it out on paper sometimes. So go practice this stuff. The things you learn in church, you're supposed to go practice. You don't just switch it off and walk out the door until next Sunday. You got to go and practice it, and then you'll grasp it. You'll get your hands around it in a way that you never could when you only engaged your brain and your ears. Go practice this stuff. All right. Years ago, I made a decision to follow Jesus, but I made another decision. I decided I wanted to learn to ride a bicycle. So, I went to the library and checked out a book called How to Ride a Bicycle. Because if you want to learn something, you go to the library, right? You get a book. Now, this wasn't a comic book, mind you. This wasn't a booklet. It was a book. I mean, a 2-inch thick, bona fide, hardback book called How to Learn to Ride a Bicycle. And I was going to read that and memorize the concepts, the precepts, and the 12 easy steps. And I was going to walk out of that library ready to ride a bicycle. Big, thick. Did I mention it was a thick book? It was compelling is what it was. It was riveting. It was a page-turning book. Not many pictures, but lots of words. And I took each one of them into my heart. It wasn't an old book. It was a very modern book, not a dusty book. It was so hip that it had links printed in there to go to YouTube to watch videos to supplement my education so that I would be even better yet at riding a bicycle. I read it from cover to cover. When I finished reading this book, I immediately walked to Walmart and bought myself a shiny new bike. I couldn't wait to begin riding my shiny new bike. You know where I went next? The emergency room. That's exactly right. You can know all the facts, but there's more to riding a bike than knowing the right things. You got to practice this stuff. You got to read the book, watch the videos, practice, practice, practice. And that's how you master the content. You Methodists invented Sunday school. I'm sure you're aware of this. Before there was public school, there was Methodist. Praise God. Some of you were in the first class. No, just kidding. Before there was public school, there was you. Now, public school exists to prepare you to do something. The school I grew up in has switched to the uniform dress code. And so everybody has to wear a solid color shirt and khaki pants. So you know what they're preparing people for? Employment at Taco Bell. But public school exists to prepare you for something, to prepare you for a job or a career, to prepare you for a vocation, which means calling. The public school exists to prepare you for the future, to prepare you to go and do, to prepare you for your calling. So why does Sunday school exist? Well, Sunday school exists to prepare you for your number one calling, for your true vocation, foot washing. That's your number one job. Everything else is just how I get money. You know, men define themselves by how they get money. But we don't say, hey, how do you get money? We say, what do you do? And they begin to tell you. If it's interesting, they'll tell you what they do. If they find it interesting, they might talk for an hour and you haven't yet found out that it's interesting. But we tend to define ourselves by what we do. But it might be better to say, I'm a foot washer who sells screwdrivers for money. Because your true vocation is foot washing. Everything else is just gravy. There once was a British boy, mind you, named Edwin, who dreamed of being a spy. He saw all the shows, James Bond, Austin Powers, Get Smart. He wanted to learn all about how to be a spy. He saved his money. He bought all the spy gear, all the toys and gadgets that little boys play with when they're playing spy. When he was old enough, I told you he was British, remember? He went to MI6 to go to spy school and be a spy and become a spy when he was old enough. That's what he did. And he was the top of his class. He was the smartest, strongest, dedicated, quick-witted, passionate, problem solver, learned all the spy stuff. He was the whole package. He was expected to be the best spy they ever trained for the Secret Service. Then, when he completed his training, he graduated. He took an oath. He participated in the ceremony with pomp and circumstance. He was finally an official spy. For his first assignment in His Majesty's Secret Service, he was assigned to go to the U.S. and pose undercover as a hammer salesman. He fell in love with the great schedule and all the perks and comforts that go along with being a hammer sales associate. He took exotic trips to Omaha for the annual hammer convention. He got a new Oldsmobile Company car every 2 years. He liked it so well, he never did any spying. He just kept on pretending to be a hammer seller. Eventually, he forgot all about his true identity. He eventually forgot all about his purpose, his dream, and his calling. He just sold a boatload of hammers. And he was good. He could sell a hammer to an Eskimo. It's mixed metaphors are funny. He made a comfortable living. He made a comfortable living selling hammers. Even die with a few dollars left, which is our goal, isn't it? To die with just a few dollars left. I remember my favorite thing about Wesley is he said, if I die with more than 10 pounds in my pocket, you can call me a hypocrite. Something like that? Is that close? I like it. You want to come in skidding broadside to your own funeral. Break even. That's the best thing you can hope to do. And Edwin did. He had a few dollars left when he passed from this earth. Was he a successful spy? No. Was he a spy at all? No. Why? He went to school, pledged the oath, pomp and circumstance, did the whole nine yards, knew all the stuff, had all the gear, did all the tricks, top of his class. Not a spy. Why? Because spies spy. Spies do spying. If you don't spy, you're not a spy. Say that 10 times fast. Spying is something you do. It is an occupation. It is an activity in which one engages. Edwin forgot that he was an agent on a mission for his king. I've met a lot of people who have officially become a Christian but have forgotten along the way that they are an agent of the kingdom of God. They aren't conspiring. Hello? They aren't sneaking around sabotaging the devil's plans. They aren't plotting to overthrow any strongholds. They're not rescuing anyone trapped behind enemy lines. Friends, thank you. Not everybody knows how to receive preaching. Friends, our calling, our vocation, is to be agents working for the kingdom of God. An agent is someone who acts on behalf of another. A person who takes an active role and achieves a result. A Christian is a servant, and a servant serves. If a servant ain't serving, he ain't a servant. If a Christian ain't a servant, he ain't a Christian. However, let me make something crystal clear to you, lest you misunderstand me and get sidetracked. Because if you can find a hole in my message, you'll say, I don't have to believe any of that stuff that hippie preacher said. They call me a hippie because they don't have any more words to describe a person as ugly as me. So I just get thrown in with the people who have long hair on the back of their head. Let me make something crystal clear to you. Service comes from gratitude. I'm not here to say that you'd better get some foot washing done if you intend to have a spot behind the pearly gates. Not what I'm here to tell you. I'm not going to say that you ought to feed the hunger in order to ensure your place among the saints. I'm not telling you to clothe the naked in order to earn anything. I'm here to tell you to serve others because you're going to heaven. Because you're going to heaven, you can't help but serve others. You are a child of God. You have hope and a purpose. You've got a heart full of love. Who could stop you from serving others? Because you're just so excited about it. You're so happy that you have something to do. You're never bored. A Christian's never bored because the need is so great. Who could stop you from serving others? It's what we do because we affirm the truth. Service is normal kingdom behavior. A general observation made in any church in North America has taught us that service is an extracurricular activity, and being a Christian is really about attending services, receiving good teaching, and observing venerated rituals. Good news, friends. Kingdom life is more, and it's better. Let's open up our Bibles if you have them. There's one in the pew in the back of the seat in front of you. On the rack on the back of the pew in front of you. That was always the tongue twister for the song leader. Your hymnal is located on the back of the pew in front of you. James 1, verse 27. You know this in by heart, though, if you've been here a minute. The Bible says in James chapter 1, verse 27, I'll be reading from the NIV, but you read from whichever Bible that you have handy. I'm not here to harp on that. Any of them will get you there, more or less. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. What we have here, my friends, is one of my other favorite words. We have a juxtaposition. I went to college. Really, there's a magazine, an art magazine called Juxtaposition. That's where I learned the word. I'm really not fancy. Ask anybody who's met me 10 minutes ago, and they'll tell you, not fancy. Juxtaposition is the act or an instance of placing two or more things side by side to demonstrate contrast. Think, one of these things is not like the other. Don't sing the song, but you know it. 1968, the first episode of Sesame Street, we learned the earworm song, One of These Things Is Not Like the Other. It's like my family photo. People look at it and go, one of those things is not like the other. And that word in this verse is religion. Now, religion is a very common and comfortable word in our vernacular. We hear it and use it every day. When someone asks what your religion is, most of us would answer without hesitation, Christian, Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu, flying spaghetti monster, other. Lots and lots of others these days. But we're not alarmed by this word. It's a normal word. But did you know that the word religion is only used once in the entire New Testament Bible? Only once. Right here in this passage, James chapter 1, verse 27. And this foreign object, this word that is placed here, that is that is one thing that's not like the other, ought to make our ears perk up. It ought to draw our attention, because this word religion stuck in this verse creates a contrast. Let me demonstrate the contrast. Religion in the Jewish mind and every other mind, because everybody's religious. Everybody in the Bible times was religious. They just weren't God followers. They weren't big G God followers. Religion in the Jewish mind and most others meant going to a certain place at a certain time and doing certain things in certain ways. That describes every religion that has ever existed on earth. Even the small g Greek gods had a prescription for gaining their favor. And it went something like this. Go to a certain place at a certain time and do certain things in certain ways, and the gods will smile on you. Sadly, we've copied that more than we meant to. We're not nearly as raw and gritty as the disciples in the second chapter of Acts. They just did whatever needed to be done next. They didn't always have an order of worship. And they went to heaven. Can I get an amen? Order of worship's good. My people, their favorite verse was decent. Everything should be done, decency in order. But the thing about it, James puts this word religion there and steps back so we can look at it, and then he throws us a curveball. He defines real, bona fide, authentic religion not as observing holy liturgies, pious rituals, or formal observances. Instead, the Bible says in James 1, chapter 27, that pure religion is looking after widows and orphans and not buying into the world's worthless values. The new covenant standard for officially drawing near to God is surprisingly unpretentious and altogether devoid of pomp and pageantry that commonly accompanies the word religion. Kind of like foot washing. Nobody says, ooh-wee, fancy. That's a fancy towel you got there. It's enough here with Tupperware. See her with a Tupperware basin? It's good enough for foot washing. Good enough for our Lord. This is the example that we should follow. As He has done, we should do for each other. As friends, is the new piety. This is the new wine that will not fit in the old wineskins. Charles Finney was a Wesleyan minister who invented the altar call. However, when he called people down the aisle, when he offered the invitation, asking folks to walk down the aisle, he was doing something different than we would commonly do. He's doing something different than Billy Graham would do. He would call people down the aisle not to ask people to commit their mind to Christ. He was asking folks to give their life to Him. He was standing out here on the front row signing up people. He had a clipboard. He was signing up people to oppose slavery and injustice in their world. He wasn't just saying, come and agree to a list of beliefs. He's preaching to the church. We already agreed. Next step, let's do something. He said, respond to all 74 verses of Just As I Am. Is that a song you sing? And come down here and commit to act. Commit to do. Commit to changing the world. To make it a better place. To usher in the kingdom of God. There will be an altar call in a few minutes. And when we do that, I invite you to come forward and commit your hearts and your hands and your backs and your elbow grease and your pocketbooks to the service of Jesus. Start again today.
Just before we pray and invite the ushers forward to share in our morning tithes and offerings, a reminder, as always, that we receive prayers as an offering. And so an invitation to those of us that are worshiping here this morning in person to reach for the prayer card on your bulletin and to make a mark for prayer in your life or the life of someone you're thinking of. To mark on the card whether you would like your prayer to be shared on the prayer chain, or if you have a confidential prayer, to mark that on the card and to drop it in the plate. Throughout this month, we've been renewing our commitment. If you haven't yet done so, we ask that you would take the back of that card and make a mark of the commitment of yourself to prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness in Christ's church this year, and to place the card in the plate. If you're worshiping with us virtually, be it this morning or throughout the week when your time of worship comes, we invite you to share prayers in the comments section, or if you have confidential or private prayers, to direct message us, and I will receive your prayer to pray with you and to pray for you this week. Lastly, let me simply say that if you would like to make a gift, and I know this morning we didn't go through many of the points of Hunger Relief Army, but if you would like to make a gift to help feeding hungry people and filling food pantries, if you reach for an offering envelope in the pew this morning and mark Hunger Army, just make the checkout or your cash, either way, mark on there for Hunger Relief. The ushers will collect the offerings, and this week those monies will be pulled together and given to Jeff and to the ministry of our Hunger Relief Army. But let us take pause to pray the prayer of Jesus as we prepare to share prayer cards and commitment cards and offerings either to the church or to the feeding of our hungry neighbors. And so let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, ushers, would you come?
Yeah. yourselves, ready yourselves. Let it shine the light of Jesus in the darkest night. Whoa, ready yourselves, ready yourselves. Let the powers of darkness tremble.
Stand and join us in the doxology.
One, two, three.
As we put into our heart what the Lord intends that we put into our practice, this morning's prayer we lift from the words of St. Francis of Assisi. And so let us come together. Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope, and where there is darkness, light, and where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek as to be consoled, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. to share prayers among the people this morning, a number of names on our prayer list, to lift and share some of the joys this week. We do have a birthday to celebrate today. Officer Ronnie Morgan's birthday is today. Be sure to give Ronnie a shout today or this week. We have three birthday girls on January the 31st. Miss Carol Wilson, Miss Denise Willoughby, and Miss Jennifer Crumball all share a birthday on January 31st. Happy birthday, ladies. On February 2nd, Miss Polly Cloud, and great to see Polly and Robert here this morning, and Karen Wheeler. And then an anniversary. Charles and Vanna Jennings have a Valentine to celebrate on February the 4th. A number of names of prayers for those in our church and community. Just to lift a word about a few, we want to continue to pray for Miss Sally Colburner and their family with the passing of her father. We're glad to see that Brother Barrett Jones had a successful procedure at the dentist's office. We continue to lift prayers for Miss Melissa Morgan, slowly regaining strength from her accident and hoping to be back to work and out and about after a very serious car accident. Continuing prayers for both Paula Stevens and Joe Simmons at home doing rehab from knee surgery. Prayers for Miss Polly Cloud as she renews and yet awaits a next procedure. Continuing prayers as well for the Wurtenbergers, and glad that Larry and Roxy are here this morning. Prayers for Jerry and Sharon. Jerry is starting to get on his feet and to regain strength in his legs, and we continue to pray for his health and wellness. To pray for Miss Betty Bragg, to pray for Stan McPeak, for Stan Grimmett and Becky McPeak, and their fighting of the good fight with cancer. But let me ask now, what joys and concerns do we want to lift with one another? And let me steal a pen. What joys and concerns do we want to lift with each other? Miss Denise.
Oh, wow, and I'm sorry I missed it. Happy birthday. Are y'all having a little birthday party today and eating some cupcakes and ice cream, I hope? Birthdays should last at least a week, don't you guys think? You telling me Nana and Pops can't buy y'all some ice cream today? Sure you can, Pops. Come on. Happy birthday, y'all, for real. And I'm so glad that y'all are here and you brought Nana and Pops with you. Other joys and concerns. I see Julie. I see a hand in the back. All right. And my bad for missing. Prayers for Shelly and Randy celebrating an anniversary. Other hands.
Yes, sir. Joe, tell us.
Yeah, I'm just so excited to see us all together, and I'll be honest with you, it touched my heart seeing you here, and some folks that hadn't been here in a while have been sick for various reasons. I'm just so happy to see you. It touches my heart.
Amen.
And the Holy Spirit has touched my heart, and just as we heard, we're step one, we got step two, three, four, five. Let's get out and work and tell people about Jesus' love. Amen. And go out and share the love of Jesus and help everybody that we can.
Amen. That's a man we all know for 3 years through this pandemic all the time stood up and said, pray for the people who aren't here. Pray for the people who are at home. Pray for people to get back to church. That's a prayer answered right there in the pew.
Amen.
Thank you for your witness, Joel. Hey, in the back, Miss Lynn.
110 today.
110%? Oh, 110 people, all right, that are, and all our friends on the computer and all that too, but all y'all's that's here. Amen. I didn't mean to steal your thunder. I was thinking percent. I was waiting for like a razor back up. Yes, sir. Brother Biff, tell us. If you weren't able to hear in the back or online, and you'll note from our prayer list and the families we're praying for, one of those is Dennis's brother Bill Whitby, and his cancer is now the size of a... All right. We want to continue to pray for victory for Brother Bill Whitby as well. Did I see hand in the back? Don't have me to miss you.
My brother, Logan Morgan, is having complications from this.
Okay, Miss Marilyn Evans asked prayers for your brother, and tell me it, Logan. For your brother Bogan Morgan. Prayers for brother Bogan Morgan. Thank you, Miss Marilyn. Others?
For the family of
Marcia
Carter Harris. She passed away yesterday.
For the family of Marcia Carter Harris in her passing yesterday. For the family of Marcia Carter Harris. Others?
Justin. Yes, sir. They're maybe showing some signs of improving, but still not capable of taking care of themselves yet.
You'll note we are continuing to pray for Lindolf Ziegler, for Tracy's father and mother. Lindolf had been hospitalized but is home, but still trying to work through getting well. And so we want to continue to pray for Lindolf as well as for Tracy, in many ways, the caregiver to her dad and to her folks. Others that you want to lift prayers for this morning, or has anybody got any for me to watch from the internet? Webs. I don't want to miss anyone.
Justin, my nephew Jimmy has surgery on February 3rd.
Miss Penny Green lifts prayers as we continue to pray for her nephew Jimmy. He'll be having surgery upcoming on February the 3rd. Prayers for brother Jimmy. Others that you want to lift this morning. Nicole. All right, there's a good one. Thank you, Miss Nicole. We're glad that you are cancer-free. Prayers for Miss Nicole Cox at Locke, and prayers that that you continue to have good health. Others that you want to lift this morning. Other joys or concerns. I see Henry stand up. No, he's just reaching for Paul. Others. Once, twice. Well, let us come to rest just for a moment. And as you do, I want to offer an invitation to you as you come to rest. And in a moment, we will share in our last song of praise, "Here I Am, Lord," that we give ourselves again to God this day, that we give our heart, and as Brother Jeff said, our life. To invite you, if you feel so led, to come to the altar, to spend a moment in prayer, perhaps for one of these, for another, or even simply for yourself. I'll ask Brother Jeff to come if he would like to make an invitation to you, to the Lord's altar, and to this chancel.
This is the very best kind of invitation. Sometimes you've got a sin in your life, but it's embarrassing, it's a secret, and you don't know what people will think of you if you were to walk down the aisle, if you were to share it. But that's not the kind of invitation we're having today. I mean, you can do that. We'd love to hear all the juicy details. But that's not what we're offering today. If you want to take step one today and say, "I believe and I want to begin my faith journey," the invitation is open for that also today. We don't want to hinder anybody from coming to faith in Christ. But today, the invitation is to commit your life to foot washing, to commit your life to daily towel service for the glory of Jesus Christ. And so there's no reason to be ashamed, because we got plenty of front rows around here to fill up, and we will pray together, and we won't gossip about you. We'll be so proud that there are people among us that want to serve, that want to serve more, that want their life to matter, and that want to draw people into the light of Jesus Christ through their service. Your service doesn't just help you grow spiritually, but it helps the community see that this church matters. What would we do without the Salem Methodist? That's what we want them to say. We're not quite there yet, but we want them to say that. If this church were to disappear, would anyone notice? We're going to make sure they notice. So today, as we offer the invitation, you can come down and receive prayer to dedicate your life to service for the glory of God and for leading more and more people to His Son, to remove obstacles between people and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. This is your invitation.
Would you all stand and join us?
One, two, three, four.
Together. Father, we thank you for your word that guides our steps. We thank you for all the eternal truths that you've revealed to us so that we know what good things to go do. Father, as we leave this place shortly, we say these words, "Here am I, send me." And we pray that we can be the hands and feet of Jesus, that we can be the light in the dark place, lighting up every corner, not just of this church building, but lighting up every corner of Salem, of Benton, of Saline County, that people may know your son, that people may live lives that are fully alive because they are participating in the kingdom of God right along with you, washing feet together with our brothers and sisters. In Jesus' name, amen.